with environmental history. The first one would be translated in French by Histoire environnementale, so it is exactly the same as the English expression. And it would be a monodisciplinary approach, an historical approach to the environmental problems. That means that in this field of research, historians do as usual, and it's not a criticism, it's just like it is, but they address new topics, for instance, environmental justice or pollution or the regulation of pollution, resource management, and so on. And so they open new archives and look at what is the history of those new topics. Another one is called the Histoire de l'environnement, that is history of environment. Even if again in English the two are the same words, environmental history. And this would be more an interdisciplinary approach to this history, taking into account the physical dimension of the environment and the physical dimension of the relationships between societies and the biosphere. From time to time, but not always, this kind of history is driven by natural sciences. That means that these are natural sciences that are the leader and who interest in the question of the transformation of the environment through social actions. So in France, not everybody agrees to say that Histoire de l'environnement is a historic approach, but I think that it is also an important way to look at those questions, as we can say that we live in a material world, and that this world, as we know, is quite transformed, and this is a very important question. And for the record, I mentioned Géohistoire. It is also perhaps quite a French thing, because in France, geographers and historians are always fighting. So when geographers are dealing with history, they don't want to say that they are historians, and so on. So they say that they are making Géohistoire. So this is for the environmental history affair. And so I had decided to be very, very, very respectful of the time, but I forgot to put the pin in the... Okay. And what is then urban environmental history? We could say it's easy, it is the application of the same as the previous one, but applied to the city. What we could say is that urban environmental history was born during the 1970s as environmental history. It's not so surprising if you look at the emergence of the environmental question. And in the urban context, it is strongly connected to history of technology, for instance, very important urban environmental historians in the United States, Martin Melosi and Joël Tard, so in the order of appearance, Joël Tard and Martin Melosi, were also and are also historians of urban technology. Their approach is strongly connected to the history of networks, sanitation, energy distribution, and so on. It is also, of course, connected to economic history, industrial history, and so on. And this field of research, at the beginning, and perhaps to some extent today also, had quite a low recognition among the environmental historians and also among the urban historians. The reason being that the city would be the place of the social, and a completely or nearly completely artificial place. So it is not a place for environmental concerns or studies or history. But nevertheless, it developed since the 1990s, even if it began previously. And there are quite, in the two fields, Histoire de l'environnement and Histoire de l'environnement, but we can say that there is still quite a weak presence of this kind of research. If we look at the programs or the conferences of the European Association of Urban History, we can see that there is very small parts dedicated to environmental concerns. And if we look on the other side, at the conference programs of the European Society for Environmental History, again we see that the urban is not very important in these programs. The reason being that some say that if we look at the urbanized space, at the surface of the planet, it is very small. If we compare it to the oceans, to the forests, to the mountains, and so on. But of course, these cities have a huge impact and a huge demand on environmental resources and ecosystems. So reverse the argument. So in the end, after having said all this, in this talk, what we have been, what I will do is to focus on more and. An environmental history based on an interdisciplinary approach, and what I would like to show is the importance to look at this material dimension of the urban history. This material approach can be connected to what is called today a socio-ecological studies that cover a wide range of research, not only in historical dimension, but in most of the case in contemporary dimension. But both socio-ecological studies have approaches to time, they are interested in processes and in change. And they do this thanks to the study of what is called the social metabolism or society's metabolism. Metabolism is the use of this word can be also controversial because it comes from biology, but as you know perhaps, as soon as the word was invented by a biologist, Marx used it for the description of the society and the way society was using natural resources. So it is an argument or reason to say that I can use metabolism in the sense I use it or they use it. And what is this metabolism? It is just the flows of energy and materials that society use in order to maintain the functioning of the society, to give to have food, to move, to rest, to do nice things and ugly things and so on. And in socio-ecological studies, the word history is not so much used. The main word to describe, to deal with time, is trajectory. And the idea is that there are several socio-ecological regimes that succeed in time, that are characterized by a special metabolism. And the change in the socio-ecological regime through the trajectory is called a transition, but it's also a controversial word. In fact, I think that speaking is very difficult because everyone is controversial. And socio-ecological studies use mostly quantitative approach, so material and energy accounting. The idea is to count watts or joules or tons or kilos, etc., etc. But there is a strong focus on energy and on use, perhaps I will have some time to say things about it. In the general view of those studies, there are three main regimes that characterize societies through the long time of human life. The first one would be fire or ultra-gamma's regime. I won't go into this because it is not the purpose of your group. The second one would be the agrarian regime, which was developed several thousand years ago, that is based on solar energy, of course. The primary energy source is provided by the biomass, so that is by forest and by grain and so on. And this metabolism is more or less circular. That means that everything that is taken from the nature by the human society is given back to it and goes back into the natural biogeochemical cycle. I have put some indication about the energy intensity of those regimes, but I don't have so much time to speak about this. And what do you like say about the Hungarian regime, but a little bit of change. And led to what is called the industrial regime, and with a main transformation in the energy provision and a decoupling between energy provision and land use, because land is no more the way, the place that gives energy, but it has given the notion of subterranean forest by CIFER, that is all those fossil fuels that I used to allow societies to do what they have to do. And also with a fast growing of flows and stocks of energy and materials and significant environmental consequences. And the other thing that characterizes this metabolism is that it is now linear. That means that societies take things from nature, they transform them, they use them, and then they discharge them to nature in other places, in different forms, and those things accumulate, for instance, carbon in the atmosphere, or nitrates in the water, and waste on the land, and so on. And this would be the very characteristic of this industrial regime. These approaches are very interesting, I think. And they were developed in several places around the world, several research teams, one of them in Vienna, in Austria, through the Institute of Social Ecology. And what are the limits of these approaches is that from time to time they can look a little deterministic. It seems that change is a little ineluctable. There is a transition because there is a transition. There is a resource exhaustion, so we change resource use and so on. And when we look at history, and of course history of cities, things seem a little different. So I think that there is a need to historicize, I don't know if this word exists in English, this kind of approach. And also, it seems that this industrial regime, for instance, is everywhere the same. Everywhere on the planet, and of course, if we look at different places, we can see that it is completely different. If we are here in Bayern, I can't say Bayern, or in Paris, or of course in Cairo, what was mentioned previously, and so on. So my point is that what we need is more local, specialized, and historical approaches to those metabolic approaches. And it is what I'm going to illustrate now, I think. Yes? Yes. It is the transition to the second part. So, what I am going to show now is this kind of metabolic approach applied to urban history. And before going on, I would like to stress the fact that we can have a completely metabolic understanding of cities, and we could say that cities are born of a metabolic story, because we could say that they are born from the efficiency of the agricultural metabolism, and thanks to the production of food surplus, that made possible market exchanges and that were responsible for the birth of those cities. In addition to this, that means that the metabolism of cities is very particular, whatever the regime, agrarian or industrial, because it is at least in part externalized, because cities depend by definition on other spaces, territories, regions, in order to be supplied with food. And that means that is important, even if we are not concerned with present day discussion. But it is important to say that, in this sense, the urban self-sufficiency is a kind of oxymoron, because the reason for the city is to not be self-sufficient, but dependent on other spaces. Other characteristics of urban metabolism are the density of density in terms of space, because a huge amount of population is in a very small area. So that means that there is a convergence of flows in this small space. The presence of huge stocks, because there are buildings, infrastructures, and so on. And another thing, that is the role of the finite consumption, because, and mostly during the 20th century, with the growing urbanization process, most of the things that are produced everywhere in the world finish, could I say, in the city, and finish on the form of waste, air, soil, and water. But it's what the blue city. But I like cities. And I will illustrate this through the case of Paris, as I mentioned previously. And what I would like to look at is this transition from agrarian to industrial regime. How did it go? Was it a linear process or not? What were the main drivers of this change? And this will be my second part, and my third part will deal with the extra urban impact of cities and the way cities are connected to other territories through time during this transition from agrarian to industrial regime. Okay, so our second part, energy and material flows. So what are the major changes in energy and material flows in a city like Paris? What is very... well, I have put together some results of lots of research we have made with colleagues and doctoral students since, I would say, 20 years, which is a little messy, but I would like to make it less messy. What is important when we look at this transition from agrarian to industrial regime is that there are very, we can see that there are very, two different paths, completely different paths. What we would say is the 19th and the 20th century, but as you know, it is very difficult to say. It is here what is the difference, the year, the very year that we can choose to make the share. And so I will say some words about the 19th century. I know that it is not your concern, but it is to go better to the 20th century after. Not surprisingly, we could say that this century is a more linear one than the previous one. This can be, and that flows are growing, as it is the case for every industrializing regime. This is quite obvious if we look at, at water. This is water consumption in Paris, and this concerns the 19th century, and you can see this tremendous increasing amount of water that is consumed. This is just due to the fact that water became the main way to clean things. And for us, it is obvious today that water must be used to clean everything, the body, but also the streets, the buildings, the factories, and so on. But it was not the case previously, and this new role for the water had huge consequences for the resource consumption. Then you see the rainwater amount that is going on Paris, and you can see that since the half of the 19th century, these anthropogenic amounts are more important than rainwater. So, okay, growing flows, more linear because this water is discharged to the river and so on. That's not surprising. But what we can see here concerns now energy. We have several points that can be highlighted. This is a result of the PhD thesis of Uniki. And this is final and primary energy. During the 19th century, there is not so much difference between the two. The only difference is the green here that concerns gas, but was produced thanks to this is also a way to put into perspective economic history and environmental history, because economic history, especially for Paris, has been very concerned with gas manufacturing. But when we look what it is represents in energy consumption, it is not so much, and most important, direct consumption of coal and here of wood. And I wanted to say two things by showing this picture. It's first that energy transition is quite long, it is not specific to Paris. At the beginning of the 19th century, there was nearly no coal in used in consumed in Paris, and we can say that the transition is long in the mid-19th century when coal represents 50% of the share. But the other thing that's quite surprising, that was quite surprising for us when we did this, this research, is that you can see that the per capita energy consumption is quite stable. And we thought before doing this that it would have increased because of industrialization, the beginning of consumption, the most heating in housing, etc., and so on. And this is true, that was industrialization in Paris. Heating was developing and so on. But what we discovered by making additional inquiries, and especially in the field of history of technology, is that the reason for this stable consumption is only energy savings. That is that one of the during this century, one of the main concern of energy policy that were driven by the state, but also by the city, and energy strategy from industrialists and so on, was of course to go from wood to coal, but first of all to make energy savings. And that means that energy use increased, but we can't see it because of these savings. Another thing that is important for the 19th century metabolism is that I have just said previously that it was more linear, but at the same time it was more circular. And it is a very characteristic of the 19th century because recycling activities developed a lot for two reasons. The first one being the agricultural demand for fertilizers. What you can see here is a definition of what is sanitation. Excuse me, it is in French because I have no time to translate it. But it just says that the need that sanitation must have two goals. First, to improve salubrity within the city. Second, to give back fertilizer to the countryside. And this was very, very important. And after some success, here what you can see is the recycling rate of nitrogen that is contained in food and feed in Paris. And you can see that we reach at the end of the 19th century a 45% recycling rate, that is something absolutely extraordinary that nobody can do today in any city. And the second reason for this circular metabolism is the industrial demand, because part of industries needed urban byproduct in order to produce what we had to produce. The well-known one is paper making, but we're depending on rags, and rags were collected within the cities. But other urban byproducts can be found. Like here, I have put the life cycle of animal bones, and bones are very important for some industrial activities. And I could mention other ones, but I have time. So we could say that the 19th century, if we refer to present day discussion, is the century of circular economy, whatever we think about circular economy. But this didn't last, and I go to the 20th century, and the difference with the previous one. What we can say is that during this 20th century, linearity wins. And the reason for this, first of all, and if I connect this to what I have just said a few minutes ago, is that industry and agriculture that were depending to some extent from cities by product did not need them anymore. First, we can see the fertilizer revolution, with what are called improperly chemical fertilizers, and with that are supposed to free farmers from the constraint of manure. And the second reason is the development of other raw materials for industry. For paper, it is due to the transformation of paper making from wax to directly vegetal substances, so straw and wood, as it is today. It is also due to the development of carbon and petrochemistry that gave new raw materials in order to produce, for instance, plastics, but also tins and so on. And that is to say that if we want to understand how cities became so linear in terms of metabolism, we must connect this to the history of agriculture and to the history of industry, because all these are completely intertwined. And this has a huge impact on urban metabolism. Here is the same curve as previously, but this is what happened after. So it is my peak of my previous peak. And you see that when urban fertilizer became useless, the recycling activity decreased dramatically. And in the 1960s, we were at 10% recycling rate. And today, it is something like 4% or 5%, so let's say nothing. And another illustration is the rise of a new way to deal with waste. And what is important is that in France, the word urban waste or household waste or municipal waste was not used before the end of the war. Nobody was speaking about of waste because they are not considered as waste. And the word appears in the literature, technical literature, during the interwar. And this new way to deal with waste is landfill. Landfill was used in other countries previously, especially in England, since the last third of the 19th century. But in France, what is interesting, and that refers to the previous talk, is that there has been a strong resistance from the public authority, from the technicians, to the abandonment of urban recycling. And so they try to find other ways to recycle. That's why here you can see the growth of incineration here, because incineration was used to produce energy. And if I go to my point, because I was there, you can see that one both raw materials, urban raw materials are useless. This landfilling activity develops quite a lot since just before the Second World War. Transformation, the increasing flows. Here you are also the same curve that previously with energy consumption in terms of finite consumption and primary consumption. And what we can see here is both the diversification of energy sources with petroleum products, with natural gas, but also with nuclear energy. But first of all, what is very important is the increase in per capita consumption, that is dramatic increase since the 20th century. And of course, one of the results of this is the increasing discharge to nature, so again, this linear metabolism. This is a very rough attempt to account for carbon emissions to atmosphere in Paris from an area with 3 years, beginning of the 18th century, beginning of the 19th century, and beginning of the 21st century, and 3 times kind of emissions. In blue, it's the human respiration. Nobody accounts for human respiration in carbon emissions. It's not taken into account in any assessment you see today in well, a compulsory, but it is the, not you are not supposed to emit carbon, I suppose. The red one concerns transportation, and transportation for the two first years it is animal respiration, because transportation is made by animals. And the third one concerns eating and over, and here this is per capita, and here it is for all the Paris urban area. And we can see this explosion of emission to the atmosphere. And this is carbon, this is not carbon dioxide. Well, another aspect of this transformation is land consumption. Usually in material flow accounting, so when we count for energy flows, material flows, we don't take into account land flows. But we could say that land consumption is a kind of metabolic flows. Land is a non-renewable resource, and it is quite involved in the urbanization process. And you can see here, what we can see here is the urban extension of Paris area from the beginning of the 19th century to the end of nearly end of the 20th century. And clearly, we can see that there is a change in the la pente, je sais pas comment dire, the trend. It is quite flat here, and here you can see this slope. Oh, yes, of course. Thank you very much. There is a change in the slope. And here I put some figures about this consumption. Here it is a time representation, and here it is the consumption per new inhabitant. This inhabitant can be born in the area or can come in the area to live there, and you can see this huge amount of land that is consumed during the 20th century compared to the 19th century. And even in the case of land, we can speak about linearization, because from the second part of the 20th century appears a new kind of waste, that is brownfields or wastelands, and we could say that this is the special dimension of linearity. This has been very well shown by Roberto D'Arienzo in his PhD thesis about neighbors, but we can see it also for Paris with this multiplication of wastelands. Okay, so that was for the transformation of metabolism, and now I'd like to say a few words about the extra urban dimension of urban metabolism. A way to look at this is to look at interludes. So, what I call it, huge literature about interludes, and also they can be controversial, and so on. But what we are looking at here is where do resources come from? Resources that are used for your urban supply. And here is again looking from an PhD thesis. This is the interlude for energy for Paris. You've got here the various energy sources, and here several years, so beginning of the 19th century. End of the 19th century, 1965, and beginning of the 21st century. And not surprisingly, we can see that this internet is bigger and bigger, and it is quite a global but kind of patchwork. Can we say this? An internet that is a patchwork that is all over the world. If we look at food, it is. It is a little different, but in the end it is the same. What do I mean? What you can see here is represents the areas that are supplying Paris with food at the end of the 18th century, at the end of the 19th century, and beginning of the 21st century. terms of nitrogen, that is proteins, we could you could say that why are you concerned with nitrogen? It is because most of this research has been done in connection to the Water Basin Agency, and in the Paris Basin, there is a huge problem, a huge concern with nitrogen and nitrates and ammonium discharge to the water. That is coming from industry, but also mostly from agriculture, fertilizers, and from the city, sewers, and so on. And the second reason why it is important to look at nitrogen is that it is proteins and that we need proteins. So it is a huge part of our food, our diet. What we can see here is first, it is not a question of internet, but it has connection to internet question, is the share of protein that are consumed by Paris people. And what is in red is the protein coming from meat and animal products. And you can see that this share rises a lot and from during those 2 centuries. And now it represents almost all the proteins we are consuming. And this has huge consequences in terms of environment. What we can see also is for grain in yellow, animal produce in something like pink, and fruit and vegetables in green. The origin of those food products. And what is what we can see here? I'm not so much speaking about this one, but those two. We could say that looking quickly at those two pictures, that it is not so different for those two years. The food supply seems to be quite a national one, and we could say yes, French eat French products and so on. And everybody speaks about French products these days, and our company is the same in Spain. It's horrible. And there are nevertheless two huge differences. The first is that you can see the differences in the origins, but on the expression of the change in agriculture and the specialization of agriculture and land. Here you have at the same place, or nearly the same place, grain and meat. But here, while you have grain, you don't have meat, and while you have meat, you don't have grain. This has a huge consequence in terms of internet and the globalization of urban metabolism, is that these places, especially Britain, where the environment is catastrophic, these places where there are lots of animals are not able to feed them with the local agriculture. So they have to use food that comes from other places, feed that comes from other places, and especially soya coming from the South America. So that means that in the end, the food internet is also globalized. And what we can see here in this diagram is the average supply distance for food in green and energy in brown. If we look at only this green here, we can say that, as what I was mentioning previously, so the food internet is closed. There is no problem with globalization. But if you take into account animal feed, here, we can see that the average supply distance for food is nearly the same than for energy. It is something like 3,000 kilometers average for food, whereas it is 3,800 kilometers for energy. So the those two flows are in the same situation, I can say so. So what is there is another consequence of this change, is that for cities, in the end, due to the 20th century transformation, the environmental impact of cities is more important outside of the city than inside the city. This is connected levels or environmental imprints. I am just going to illustrate this with this awful diagram. But it's not awful, but useful. This is what we call a material flow balance. So a typical study of urban metabolism. This is present-day situation, but again, it's only to illustrate this question of indirect flows. And what we can see here, so this is Île-de-France region, so this is a Paris region. And here we have all what is the material flows that are going into the region. These flows can have been extracted from the local environment, that is grain or construction materials, the most important is construction materials. Or this is represented here. Or they can have been imported. And as I said previously, cities depend on other regions and importations are very important. And here you have what is going out of the region. This can be commercial exports, this is here, or this can be emissions to nature, to water, air, and soil, and so on. So, these are the direct flows. And here what you can see is what we call the indirect flow, that is all the material resources that has been extracted from the biosphere in order to produce all what is imported into the France region. And what you can see here, as those arrows are proportional to the flows, is that those indirect flows are much more important than the direct ones. And that is, we could connect this to the question that was raised by Rainer, and then if we can also discuss it about the planetary urbanization and so on. But what is true is that the environmental impact of Paris urban area is everywhere in the world. Another aspect of this externalization of the flow is that cities have lots of dependency and extraterritorialities. In fact, if we look at a more long history, we could say that this question of extraterritoriality is very old. For instance, again about Paris, before the revolution, Paris was managing all the Seine basin in order to be supplied with wood and had quasi total control on the Seine basin for energy concerns. So this aspect of urban metabolism is not so new. But what is, and we could say that cities have lost a lot of, most of the control they had on resources with industrialization, the rise of private companies, and so on during the 20th century. But at the same time, they also own a lot of infrastructures that are rented everywhere for Paris cities in the same basin, so for Paris cities. Outside of the water basin. So here there is this is a map of the reservoirs that were built in order to supply Paris with water during the summer, because with the increasing water consumption, the Seine River was nearly empty during summer. So some some reservoirs were built that allowed to supply Paris, and these reservoirs are it's a little changing, but during all the 20th century that they had been managed by the urban authorities. And the local authorities here in these regions were absolutely not involved in the management. So it is a kind of extraterritorial control of the city of Paris. And here are some illustrations of infrastructures. And we must say that this control is mostly dedicated to water. So, to conclude very quickly, I don't philosophy of socio-ecological transition, this idea of the two phases transition between the 19th and the 20th century is very important, because we can't say that the 19th century is just the end of the previous one. There is something specific that occurs there with this this increasing circularity. But what happens is that this circularity did not resist to the increasing consumption. That means that all what is said about circularity today and green
growing.
And green growing and so on, it is, does not resist to an historical analysis. The second thing is that most of the work that is done on both subjects deals with energy, and energy of course is a driver. But we can see that there are plenty of other things here about fertilizers, about raw materials, etc., etc. So that we need to have multi-flow analysis. What I wanted to say is that I have been focusing on Paris, and of course it is a little disappointing to just speak about Paris. The thing that is important is that there are not so much studies of this kind, because to do this we need to have a lot of data, and not every city has so much data than Paris. The other city that is quite studied in this perspective is Vienna in Austria, again. But even if we don't know so much about all the cities, what we can see, of course, is that what I have said can be said for a lot of cities in Europe, even in North America. There are some differences. These differences are in the synchronicity. That is that we can see that the transition from recycling to linear occurs earlier in England. Because also a colleague that was the Collège de France, Antoine Aurélien, told me, but it is because the chemical industry in England was so good that they did not want to have all those recycling activities, and they were able to go to new raw materials and so on. But what is surprising is what I was mentioning previously about the reaction of public authority in French cities and scientists regarding the end of recycling. There really has been this kind of resistance to the birth of waste. And there are several reasons for this. One of them is that both raw materials were also benefits for the city. And the city budget was depending to some extent on those raw materials and so on. But so there are some differences. And there are also some differences during the 20th century. If we look at the 20th century, if we look for instance at the autarcy project during the Nazi period, but is really connected to this idea of recycling and so on. We can see that in the Netherlands, also the use of urban fertilizer remain very important. There is also something very important that is the role of the walls in this story, that is not so well documented. But in terms of metabolism, if we compare the First World War and the Second World War for Paris, for instance, we see that the Second World War had a very huge impact and a long-term impact